So, yeah, my name is Peter Damborg. I'm associate professor at the University of Copenhagen. I work within veterinary clinical microbiology, and I'm also head of a diagnostic lab we have called Sundvet Diagnostik, which received mainly samples from companion animals. And I've worked with Staphylococcus pseudintermedius for a while, and also you can say more generally as within antimicrobial resistance in companion animals. So, first of all, I will talk briefly about skin infections in dogs, just a very short introduction, nothing in detail. So, as you know, probably most of you, these infections are very common, and actually by far the main reason for antimicrobial treatment of dogs. And they can be caused by a variety of different bacteria, but the main one is Staphylococcus pseudintermedius, so the one you just heard about. And Staphylococcus pseudintermedius is normal flora in dogs, and we know from previous studies that dogs can harbor these to a different extent. So some dogs are what we call permanent carriers, so they always have Staphylococcus pseudintermedius in their normal flora, in the skin or in mucosal sites. Other dogs are what we call intermittent or transient carriers, so they may be positive every now and then. If we sample them over a longer time, they may be positive one time, but not the other time. And then finally, we know that a minority of dogs are what we call non-carriers, so they don't have Staphylococcus pseudintermedius at any time. And Staphylococcus pseudintermedius is what we call an opportunistic pathogen, so it may cause infections. For example, in when the dog is immunocompromised or if there's a breach of the skin barrier, it may cause infections. A bit like we see with the Staphylococcus aureus in humans. So you may say this is a Staph aureus of dogs because it behaves more or less the same way, actually. And, sorry, as you just heard, we have the MRSP that have emerged for the last since the last decade or so. From 2005 was about the first time we saw them, and then they have spread globally. And they are quite difficult to treat because they can be resistant to a lot of different antibiotics, sometimes actually all the antibiotics we have for veterinary use. So they are quite unwanted. And this is just to show what a Staphylococcus pseudintermedius looks like on a blood agar plate. So, very briefly, just to show some examples of the skin infections we can encounter. It can be relatively mild, where we have some reddening of this is in this case the groin of a dog, or we have some inflammation of the cheek of the dog. We can have some more severe wound infections, or as you see here, this is a deep pyoderma where we have furunculosis in a dog, and actually this may be difficult to see, but we have exposure of the bone underneath. So it can be mild and it can be very severe, and of course cause a lot of pain and suffering in these dogs. So in our research group, we asked the question, can we eradicate Staphylococcus pseudintermedius and thereby also, of course, MRSP by breeding for dogs that are free of this bacterium? And of course, this is a, you can say, a controversial question. But what we thought is, at least in theory, if we get rid of this bacterium, we could also reduce a lot of suffering in the dogs, and of course also a lot of antimicrobial usage. So what we speculated was that perhaps the sequence of DNA somewhere in the dog's chromosomes could be determining for whether Staphylococcus pseudintermedius is present in the dog or not. So here you see an example of a chromosome in the dog and the DNA sequence, and perhaps somewhere in this sequence there is some specific sequence that determines the dog as a carrier or a non-carrier. So based on this, we made the objectives to determine whether Staphylococcus pseudintermedius carriage status is related to the dog's host genotype or DNA type, if you want a different word for that. And secondarily, we had another objective to determine if this carriage status is related to the presence of skin infections or symptoms of skin disease. And I told you before that we know that it's a cause of Staphylococcus pseudintermedius, it's a cause of skin infections, but we actually don't know if this carried status is related to skin infections in dogs. So whether there's a higher chance of dogs with which are permanent carriers getting skin infections compared to dogs that are intermittent or non-carriers. That we don't know. So the study we did, we had a study set up including Labrador retrievers from Sweden and from Denmark. And you may ask yourself, why Labradors and why from Sweden and why from Denmark? Why not just from Denmark? But this is because we relied on previous data obtained as part of the Lupa project, which you may have heard about, a large European project with the genotyping of dogs. And in that project, Labrador retrievers had been involved, and blood samples had been taken from these dogs, and DNA had been extracted. And from that DNA, the dogs had been genotyped using a small chip called this name here, I don't need to say, but it's an advanced chip where you can see actually genetic variation in 170,000 different places on the dog's genome. So you get a very detailed insight into the dog's genome, the chromosomes of the dog. So that's why we chose these dogs in the study. So what we did was that we contacted the owners of these dogs and we asked them to take three samples from the dogs within a 2-month period. And every time they took samples, it took samples from the mouth of the dog and the perineum of the dog, which we know are, if you take samples from there, you're more likely to get to detect Staphylococcus pseudintermedius if the dog is a carrier. At the same time, we asked the owners to fill in a questionnaire, mainly on whether the dog had any skin symptoms of skin infection or known or previous skin infection. We also asked other questions, which I will get back to in a later slide. The owners then sent these swab samples to us in our diagnostic laboratory, and we streaked them out on blood agar, and we searched for Staphylococcus pseudintermedius. Depending on when we found or how many times we found Staphylococcus pseudintermedius from these dogs, we classified them into three categories: either permanent carriers, where the dog would be positive for Staphylococcus pseudintermedius on all three sampling occasions, or intermittent carriers, where they would be positive on one or two of the three sampling occasions, or non-carriers, where we didn't find it in any case. And afterwards, we related this these groups to whether the dogs had any current or previous skin infections or symptoms of skin disease. And we also related the carrier status to the host genotype, so the genotype that had been discovered previously as part of this Lupa project. So what we found is shown up here. We found that about half of the dogs were permanent carriers, so they were carriers of Staphylococcus pseudintermedius on all sampling occasions. 32% were intermittent carriers, and a minority of the dogs were non-carriers, where we didn't find Staphylococcus pseudintermedius at any time. And as I mentioned up here, it's not very important for these results, but we found one MRSP, and I don't remember if it was a Swedish or Danish dog, actually. So we first related this to the occurrence of skin symptoms. And we found if we looked at symptoms of skin disease during the sampling period, so during these 2 months period of sampling, we didn't see any relation, because actually only three of the dogs had some sort of skin infection. This was too low to make any logical correlation to these three groups, unfortunately. But then we also asked if they had had skin infections or symptoms at any point in life, and actually 1/3 of the dogs had that, according to the owners. And we found that most of these dogs with some kind of skin infection or skin-related symptom were actually permanent or intermittent carriers. So there was a trend towards dogs that were permanent or intermittent carriers at sometimes had this bacterium, that they also had were more likely to get an infection or symptom of skin disease. But it was not significantly, unfortunately. Then, of course, we also did this correlation to the host genotype. And we did an advanced analysis called a genome-wide association study. And I'm not even into this how it was done myself, but it was done by a genetic department. But they didn't see any link between the dog's genotype and the carriage status of Staphylococcus pseudintermedius. So again, no association. As I mentioned before, we also asked the dog owners other questions related to or not related to the occurrence of skin symptoms. And that you can see here. And actually, these questions here are in Swedish because I had two Swedish master students working on this project, veterinary master students. So those you can understand probably a little bit better. But we asked the owners different questions related to the dogs, whether they had contact to other animals, the age of the dogs, the gender, how often they washed the basket the dog was in, how often they washed the dog, etc. And the only significant association we could see was between gender and permanent carriage of Staphylococcus pseudintermedius. So what we saw was that male dogs were actually more likely to be permanent carriers than female dogs. And we thought about that. We didn't really believe this made any logical sense. Why should male dogs be more likely to be carriers than female dogs? But this is what we found. Another thing is that we are afraid this might be a false significant result because, as you can see, we had a lot of different factors that we compared statistically. And the more factors you compare, the higher the chance that one of them will, by incident, be significant. So this is what we call a type 1 error statistically. And we're afraid this, or at least we think this could be a type 1 error. But it needs to, of course, to be validated if we if should be taken for granted. We did a last attempt to analyze the data. So as you know, we had the genotype first compared to the carriage status of the dog. But we also decided, okay, now we have the genotype, why don't we compare it to the occurrence of skin symptoms in these dogs? Because we have that data already. But unfortunately, we didn't see any relation here as well. So just a little bit of discussion about the study setup. We unfortunately got less dogs involved than we expected from the beginning. We hoped that we would get on the positive side of 100 dogs, but we only got just over 60. And that's, we couldn't really do anything about it, but that's because it's not always easy to recruit dog owners for studies like this, and because some of the dogs had died in the time between the Lupa study and when we contacted them. So yeah, that was a bit of a shame. Another problem is that these symptoms of skin infection are quite difficult to interpret, and we asked the owners to do it in retrospect. So we asked them to think about when the dog, if the dog had had some kind of skin symptom within their lifetime, and that that is of course difficult even for veterinarians. So so this is, you can say, a shortcoming. And what is a skin symptom? I mean, it could be many different things. Even though we actually explained to the owner, provided them with a picture of what it should look like and so on, it may have been a shortcoming of the study. And some may have overlooked symptoms and some may have underestimated symptoms, of course. And then finally, I explained to you how we define carriage status in dogs, but other people may define it differently. We said three positive samplings, then you are a permanent carrier. But imagine if we had taken 10 samples over 1 year, I mean, then I'm quite sure we would have less permanent carriers because it's more difficult to be permanent, to have 10 positive samples in a row than 3 in a row. But this is how we have to do it because it's not been defined in the literature before what is a permanent carrier. So we made up our own decision of that. So in conclusion, we didn't find any significant association between Staphylococcus pseudintermedius carrier status and the occurrence of skin infections or skin symptoms. And also, we didn't find any significant association between the carriage status and the dog's genotype. Furthermore, we didn't see any association between the occurrence of these skin infections or symptoms and the dog's genotype. But I would like to say that, of course, these results are, you can say, we intended this to be a pilot study anyway, but with the lower number of dogs, it's, you can say it's even more a pilot study. So this, this of course, should be confirmed on a larger basis. And the next time something is done like this, you should have more stringent criteria for how you characterize dogs clinically. Perhaps it should be one veterinarian only defining what is a skin symptom, for example, instead of dog owners and doing it retrospectively. So finally, I would like to thank a few people, of course, the Danish and the Swedish dog owners. And as you can see, probably the Swedish dog owners are more happy these days than the Danish ones. And then my colleagues at the university, including my boss, Luca Guardabasi, Marete Fredholm, who was a professor at the genetics department and did the analysis of the genetics data. And then Alexandra and Anna, who were the master students involved in this study and who are now, I think, practicing veterinarians in Sweden. And then, of course, Agria or SKK's Forskningsfond for contributing to the study. Thank you.